And we're talking on the source of inner strength. That is, how do I really have this courage? I want you to write the word victory down. But write it from top to bottom. V, I below it, C below it, T below it, O below that, R below that, and Y below that. Like that, straight. You understand that? Write victory, but don't write it from left to right. Write it from the top to the bottom. Have you seen that now? Now, to have victory in our lives, I want to use that word victory and the letters of that word victory and that V, right, vigilance in front of that. Vigilance. If the soldier is going to have victory, he must be vigilant. Keep his eyes opened. He must watch the enemy. He must watch his own heart. He must watch his own eating habits. He must watch his exercises. He must be vigilant over the enemy and over himself. And vigilant over his weapon, that nobody takes his weapon away from him. If we're going to have victory, we must be vigilant. Watch the enemy. Watch and pray. Because the enemy, the devil, runs about, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I is for instruction. That soldier, if he is going to win victory, while the captain is giving instruction out, he must listen to those instructions. He must understand those instructions. He must practice those instructions. Are we going to have victory on the battlefield? Christ has given us instructions. Is the captain of our salvation, is the one that has never lost any battle. He knows where the enemy is hiding. He knows the thing that can easily make us to fall, and therefore he is giving us instruction in his word. Read those instructions every day. A man that bought a car and will not read the manual, the instruction on how to take care of that car, how to use that vehicle, that vehicle will run down. That vehicle will be destroyed before the real money that you spent on it has actually been spent. Somebody is sick. He went to the hospital. They gave him some pills, together with instruction on how to use the pills. He did not listen to the instruction very well. He can kill himself. We must listen to the instruction given in the word of God, the commandments, the warnings, so that we obey. Number one, be vigilant. Number two, I is for instruction. C is for consecration and commitment. the soldier on the battlefield, if he is not consecrated and committed, every time that he is on the battlefield, he will be crying like a baby. My wife is now at home, and because I have to fight as a soldier, I am missing my wife a lot. Mommy is now at home. I wonder how they are doing now without me. My children, I wonder now whether other children in the yard are beating them. That man is not committed to that battle. He'll be an absent-minded fighter. He might die. He'll be having self-pity every time. As an evangelist, you are going to have the victory. Don't have self-pity. Have consecration. And say, this is what I've committed my life to, and I will do it. It may rain, it may be hot, I may have to sleep in the hut in the village, I may not be able to get all the food I need every time. This is my life's goal. Only one life, and I want that life to be committed to something serious that has eternal reward. Consecration and commitment. T is for trusting in the Lord. Trusting in the Lord. Trust those promises. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And when you have that trust in the Lord, and you know that if he needs to send an angel, he will send an angel to protect me. He says, I am precious in his sight. He says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. He says, I'm the apple of his eyes. He says, I'm a peculiar treasure even unto him. And he says, I'm with you till the end of the world. Why should I fear? When Christ is behind me, and Christ is before me, and he says, I'm the one that holds on to the seven candlesticks, and he says, I know my sheep, and no man is able to pluck them out of my hand. And he says, I go to heaven to prepare a place for you. When I finish, I'm coming back for you. Why should I be afraid? Why should I run from the battle? He that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Anytime there is difficulty, remember, the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. But don't you see those enemies? Yes, I see them, but I see beyond the enemies. I see my shepherd, and he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. He anoints my head, and my cup runs over. Are you not afraid that evil will follow after you? No, my shepherd is thinking about me, and surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Are you not afraid at the end of all this preaching, he will throw you away and you'll even go to hell? No, not at all. I will dwell in his house forever. Trust in the Lord. That's how to have the victory. You're vigilant. Then you pay attention to instruction. You have commitment and consecration. You are trusting in the Lord. You are obeying the Lord. That's all in victory. Those soldiers, if they have hearing problem, they cannot go to the battle to fight. Apart from the strength of the soldier, he needs his eyes so he can be vigilant. He needs his ears so that he can listen to instruction and obey instruction. If a soldier has sight problem, he's almost getting disqualified out of the army. If he has hearing problem, he's almost out of the army. You must not have hearing problem. My sheep must still hear my voice. And then you must still be following and obeying. It's in obedience that is victory. And then R is resisting. And we have a lot to resist. One, we resist the devil. You know, the devil is always coming to try you. He's always coming to deceive you. And he's always saying, you are the worst pastor that ever lived on the face of the earth. Look at the work you are doing. You think that God will reward you? It's all a waste of time. That's the devil. Resist him. And he's saying, even your messages, your messages cannot get any soul saved. It's a lie. Don't you listen to the testimonies of members of your church? Oh, that say, I thank God. Before I came to this church, I didn't know Jesus as my personal savior. But now I thank God. Because through listening to you and responding to that altar call, now I know Jesus as my personal savior. Resist the devil. He will try to deceive you as if you are not doing any good at all, as if you are not preaching the gospel at all. He will try to discourage you. But not only resisting the devil, you see this flesh that we carry about. If we have any enemy at all, this flesh is an enemy. When this flesh is getting hungry, the flesh will say, why are you following God again? Why are you still preaching the gospel? Here you are hungry. Why not sell your birthright like Esau so you can have some pottage? When you are thirsty, this flesh will begin to cry out again and say, this is too much. If this is what the call of God means upon me, upon the body, I don't want you to be in the call of God. If you try to pray and fast at 11 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock, the body is crying again. And he's saying, food, 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 food. And you try to read Bible. Your body cries out for food. You try to pray. Your body cries out for food. And then somebody that did not remember that you existed when you were not fasting, he will prepare good food. And it's on that day of fasting, and he will say, something spoke to me to come and bring pastor food. And your body will say, here it is, here it is, here it is, now, let's eat. And you will say, I'll fast tomorrow. That thing is cancelled. Another 6 months will pass, there will be no time to fast. The flesh resists that thing. Then temptation. You know, sometimes people don't understand. You have a wife at home, but you know the wife. You see her when she is not dressing properly. She is working in the kitchen. Why should a person dress her best in the kitchen? Everybody dresses normally and a little bit rough in the kitchen. And you see her before she takes her bath. Her hair is not all well arranged. You see her while she is tired and worn out and yawning. Have you watched people when they yawn? They look ugly when they yawn. That's why we cover our mouth when we yawn, because it makes us look ugly. And you see your wife while she is tired and yawning. You know when you see other women, you see them when they are well dressed, when they set their hair properly, when they do everything well, and the flesh will say, look at them, they are more beautiful than your wife. No, they are not more beautiful. Only that you see your wife at the wrong time, you see them at the right time. You see them when they are well dressed, and they are deliberately dressing that way to attract the outsider. But your wife says, after all, he is my husband. And whether I'm in the kitchen or not, I look beautiful to her, to him. And the devil begins to tell you, look at your wife. Have you ever watched women when they are pregnant? And they suffer a lot, and they don't look as beautiful as they are ordinarily. And then you see all those other women outside, they look charming, they look smart, they look well dressed, and they look as if they have extra money to take care of themselves. And the devil will come and say, you see them, they are better than your wife. No. If your wife has the money that she had, if you can supply the same clothes that they have, your wife too will look more beautiful than they. They have maids at home that are cooking for them. They just sit on rocking chair watching television. If your wife also has a maid that will put water in the bathroom for her, do all the cooking for her, and have also some people to take care of the children, and not be pregnant every year to have children. Because when a woman has 7 children, 8 children, we should salute that woman. And if you too can make them rest a little, give them enough money, oh yes, they'll be more beautiful than those people you see outside. But thank God our wives are not complaining. And when you think they complain, they are not complaining as they could have complained. They don't have enough money to even feed. And whenever they cook that little meal, they say, my husband evangelist or pastor must eat first. People you see outside that you say they are beautiful, they eat first, and then the husband takes what remains. And so your wife is beautiful. How did you marry her? With your eyes closed? No, with your eyes open. You saw they were beautiful, that's how you married. married them. Now, if they don't look beautiful now, it's not their fault. Whose fault is it? Whose fault is it? The husband? Who are those husbands? Okay, it's our fault. So let's take care of them and resist temptation that will make us to feel that those other women outside are more beautiful. If you saw what they were covering with the clothes they wear, you'll run away from them. I want you to say, I thank God for my wife. I thank God for my wife. Those of you who are not married, I don't know what to tell you to say. Okay, I thank God I'll marry a good wife. Let's know that our wives are beautiful. Remember victory, vigilance, instruction, consecration and commitment, trust in the Lord, obedience, resisting the devil and resisting the flesh. Why is yielding to the Spirit of God? That's how to have the victory. As the Spirit of the Lord is talking to us and ministering to us, we yield to the leading of the Spirit of God. Now, the source of inner strength, looking into all those things that we have said now on having the victory, let's just briefly mention these points. Number one, may Christ your Savior also your support. Be intimate in fellowship with the Savior, in communion with your shepherd. In all the steps you are taking, always ask the Lord, what next do I do? Even messages that we're preaching, pray about those messages. Be intimate with the Lord. May Christ, who is your Savior, also your support. Number two, have a strong conviction on spiritual and eternal issues. Conviction on spiritual and eternal issues. Very quickly, I want to give you areas where you must have strong, unshakable conviction. Something you must never have any doubt about. Number one, have a strong conviction on your own call. Your call, the call of the Lord upon your life. Be sure about it. Know that God has called you a preacher, a pastor, a teacher, an evangelist. Know that this is the only thing in life that can make you happy. That if you deviate and you do any other thing as your number one priority thing in life, you will not be completely happy. Add that unchanging, unshakable conviction. I am sure the Lord called me, and he called me to do this work. Now you see, when you are sure of the call of God, if difficulty comes in that call, you will not leave that thing. Everybody has difficulty. The student has difficulty at school, but he knows, if I'm going to have anything in life, I must go through this difficulty and succeed. Be sure of your call. In John chapter 15 verse 16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. I have chosen you. Number two, have a strong conviction on Christ being the only Savior. There is no alternative. Acts chapter 4 verse 12. There is no other name given among men whereby we can be saved. Number 3, have a strong conviction on the Bible as being the word of God. There is no other revelation. Number 1, be sure of your call. What I'm doing now is the important thing, the priority of my life. No other profession to take my time. Be sure of Christ as a Savior. There is no alternative. He is the only one that can save. Be sure of the Bible as the Word of God. There is no other revelation. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration and is good for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now be sure of the experience of salvation. There is no other passport to heaven. And in Hebrews chapter 2 verses 3 and 4. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Now be sure of the end of a sinful life. Judgment at the end of a sinful life. For those unbelievers, that will motivate you and push you and drive you to go and preach to them. It is hell fire at the end of an unrepentant life. There is no escape. Let me show this and think about this a lot. There is only one life. If you may spend it, there is no duplicate. You can spend again and make right what has been wrong. Your call. There's no other profession, no other priority in your life. Christ, no other Savior. There is no alternative. The Bible. There's no other revelation. Salvation is the only passport to heaven. There is no other passport. And if people die in sin, there is no escape from the judgment of God. And you have only one life. There is no duplicate. Spend it for God. If you have conviction on these important things, it will give you courage and conviction and commitment to stay on that job. How do I maintain constant boldness and courage? Number one, by prayer. Acts chapter 4 verses 31 to 33. Number two, by faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 27. By faith he forsook Egypt, and he behaved as seeing him that is invisible. Number three, fellowship with God. Without me ye can do nothing. John chapter 15 verse 5. Number four, association with dynamic ministers of the gospel. Proverbs 27 verse 17. iron sharpness iron.
Litafin ayyukan manzanni misalai kuma sura 27 kuma karfe kuma yakan kuma gyara karfe.
Number 5, let there be real deep study of the word of God.
Na biyar kuma ka tabbata cewa kana karanta maganar Allah kuma sosai.
Proverbs chapter 24 verse 5.
Litafin misalai kuma sura 24 kuma aya 5.
Knowledge brings strength.
Sani kuma yakan kawo karfi.
Number 6, dedication to service.
Na shida kuma mika kai kuma zuwa cikin aiki.
1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 9.
Korintiya ta fara kuma sura 6 kuma aya 9.
Woe is me if I preach not the gospel.
Kai tona idan bai wa'azin bishara ba.
And love for the work and love for those who are trying to win.
Kauna kuma domin aiki da kuma wanda kake nema ka cece
shi. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 8 to 10.
A cikin littafin Tessalonika ta fara kuma sura 4 aya 8.
And because ye were dear unto us, we shared with you not only the gospel of Christ, but our own very souls, being affectionately desirous of you.
Domin kuma kuna da tamani zuwa gare mu, kuma muna so kuma mu mika wadannan abubuwa da kuma muna bukatan ku.
How did those men in the Bible maintain their courage and boldness in the Lord? They prayed a lot. They believed in the Lord. They had continual intimate fellowship with God. They associated with other ministers of the gospel. Like this meeting we're having together. Associating with one another, encouraging one another, praying for one another, even writing letters of encouragement to one another after we have left this meeting. Then they studied a lot. They were dedicated to the service. And there was great love for the work in their hearts. The engineer loves his work. The doctor loves his work. The university lecturer loves his work. And the market women love their work. Those traders love their works. The cattle rearer loves his work. We must also love our work. Why shouldn't we be happy in what we're doing? You find people that rise up and they say, I'm an engineer. And then the doctor rises up, I'm a doctor. The lecturer rises up and he says, I'm a lecturer. And the pastor is thinking, what will I say when it comes to my turn? Aren't you happy you are a pastor? Aren't you happy you are what you are? Be confident and rise up also and say, I'm a pastor, a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Love it and do it. Keep on doing it and loving it. And on the day of your death, if possible, keep on preaching the gospel until that time. And when we get to heaven, you will know the work you did was the greatest work you could have done on the face of the earth. It's good to be a doctor. It's good to be an engineer. It's good to be a professional person. It is best to be a preacher of the gospel. I believe from what we have heard today, God will grant every one of us to have courage for victory in our service. At last, I finished. Aren't you happy I could stop? Now we'll rise up and we'll pray. And we'll thank the Lord for what He has spoken to us. And we'll commit ourselves to the Lord that we will be courageous in the work of the Lord. And we will retain the victory. We'll retain the victory.